All right. In this module, we're going to talk about what does science say about low back pain. This is exciting to me. I try to, I use as much evidence-based information as I possibly can. In fact, that's what I do with everything I tell you. It's evidence-based. Nothing is my opinion. This is all science-based. What is successful treatment? What's not? So let's go through what science says, starting out with disc herniations and disc bulges. There's really three main categories of back pain, and disc herniations and bulges falls into one of those three main categories. And we'll get into what it is, how it happens, what causes it later. But let's go through right now a study that Medicare did looking at 500,000 patients. This study was done in 2017, so recently, and what it showed with patients that had back pain, specifically the type being disc herniations and bulges, that increased physical therapy visits actually reduced the cost that the patient had by 32% overall. And so again, this is more evidence that physical therapy helps the patient relieve pain as well as save money. They also indicated that physical therapy first instead of injections saved 19%. Physical therapy first instead of surgery saved 75%. And then finally, physical therapy within the first 15 days of back pain was a 27% cost savings. So you can see that the earlier we get physical therapy or movement-related non-pharmaceutical, non-surgical therapy, the better the patient does and saves more money. This is also an interesting study. This was what's called an asymptomatic imaging study. This looked at tens of thousands of people that had no pain currently. So no back pain whatsoever, ranging from the ages of 20 to 80. And what they found was pretty fascinating as far as disc herniations and bulges go. What they found was 50% of people 40 years old have a disc bulge but no pain. Pretty fascinating. 33% of people that were 40 years old have a disc herniation with no pain. So disc bulge is like a mild version of a disc herniation. But the idea here is that images do not equal pain. So in this case, an MRI and an X-ray, in this case, an MRI, because X-rays don't show soft tissue, the MRI showed disc bulges and herniations in half of the people that were imaged, but they have no pain. And so if you're out there and you have been told that your pain is caused by a disc bulge or herniation, you really need to think twice about that. Because going back to before you even had back pain, and if somebody gave you an MRI, there's a good chance. There's a 50% chance if you're 40. And that only goes up as age increases. So, for example, disc bulges at 60 or 50 is 60%, 60 is 69%, 70 is 77%. And if you're 80 years old, then here we are, 84% likelihood you have a disc bulge, but no pain. Fascinating study. This was actually a systematic review, which actually looks at lots of studies. So the highest level of science we have indicates that the image does not mean, and actually having a disc bulge or herniation does not mean you're going to have pain. So hopefully that right there makes you a little confused, because we're going to talk about that later. So you should be thinking, well, what is the cause of my pain then? If I was told I have a disc herniation or a disc bulge, there's a good chance that it's coming from somewhere else in your body. Okay. Another study looking at disc herniations and bulges was a meta-analysis, which again is a very high level of research, very accurate. And what it found was that 2/3 of disc herniations heal on their own without surgery. So that's amazing. And then the most important thing here is within months of conservative care. I believe it was within 6 months of conservative care, 2/3 of people will heal naturally. And so, again, I think this whole first lesson, this whole first introduction to this course is that the body heals itself naturally without medications, injections, and surgery. Physical therapy is the answer. And really, it's movement. If it hurts when you move, we need to identify the movements that are improper in your body and improve the motions. And that's what we're going to be talking about in this whole course. Let's talk about the second category of back pain, which is arthritis or degenerative disc disease. Kind of sounds scary. Bone on bone. Stenosis is actually the real word for this, but they all mean the same thing. And again, this study looking at tens of thousands of people that have no pain, what they found again was crazy. 88% of people without pain have arthritis or disc degeneration at the age of 60. So if you're 60 years old, there's an 88% chance you have this in your spine, whether or not you have pain. Again, this is not the cause of your pain. You look at 70 years old, 93% of people have disc degeneration. And their 80s, 96% of people. So it's almost like arthritis of the spine is natural aging process. It's like wrinkles on the skin. It is very important to recognize that your image, your MRI, X-ray in these cases here with arthritis, this is not an indicator for what is actually causing your pain. It is the structure of your spine. It's changing over time. It's normal. And it does not equal pain. In fact, here we go. If you're 60 or 50 years old, 80% of people have this without pain. So that's the majority of people listening. Even in your 20s, if you're 20 years old listening to this course, there's a 37% chance you have arthritis, disc degeneration, stenosis in your spine. But in this case, these people had no pain. So fascinating, I think. Very important for us to talk about this science first before we get into it. Here's a visual representation. So you can see in the blue, let's orient you. So on the x-axis, that's going to be percentage of people. In the y-axis, it's age. And then the colors. Blue is disc degeneration. So you can see that as the age goes up, the likelihood of having disc degeneration increases significantly. But again, these are people without pain. The green bar is disc bulges, again, increases significantly as age increases. Again, these people have no pain. So even if you're in your 20s, there's a 35% chance you have a disc bulge with no pain. Again, fascinating study. Now, if we talk about surgeries, studies indicate that surgeries are skyrocketing. They're increasing like crazy. There was 500,000 plus disc surgeries annually as of 2017, a significant increase in the last 10 years. I believe it's a 15-fold increase in the past 6 years. Research suggests that as many as 90% are unnecessary and ineffective. That's a quote by Dr. MD, professor at Oregon's University, Richard Deo. Research indicates that 2 years after surgery, less than 50% are in less pain. So that's crazy, right? I mean, think about that. Less than 50% of people after a back surgery are in less pain after 2 years. Dr. Dano also is quoted by saying that there's a 15-fold increase in the past 6 years of surgeries and mentions one strong motivation, which includes financial incentives involving both the surgeons and the hospitals. The reality is the more surgeries we do, the more the hospitals and the surgeons make. Not good. Okay, so the average cost of a back surgery, you can see that the first two are neck surgeries. The cervical fusion is $44,000. The decompression surgery is $24,000. A lumbar laminectomy, which is what I had when I was 24, is $18,000. And a lumbar spinal fusion is $34,500. Now, those are just the surgeon's charges, right? Dr. Deo found the mean hospital costs alone for surgical decompression and complex fusions range between $23,000 and $80,000 for just the hospital costs. And then you combine that with the surgical costs, which is listed above, and medications and imaging, which is always done, rehabilitation and disability, the average spine surgery cases are approaching $100,000 or more. Mine was $105,000 as a 24-year-old. And the direct costs are astronomical and may reach as high as $169,000 for a lumbar fusion and $112,000 for a cervical fusion. It's unbelievable the costs here, and you're paying $100,000 or more for less than 50% success rates is what this picture paints. It's a huge problem. It's on the top 10. Back pain is on the top 10 list of diseases in America. It stands at number 8, costing $40 billion annually alone to treat. And the success rates are terrible. Back pain is the number one cause of disability, and 3 million people visit the ER in 2008 at a cost of $9.5 billion. And remember, previously we talked about the ER being unnecessary imaging, expensive imaging, and medications and rest are the most common treatments, which don't fix the problem. Medication, you cannot fix a mechanical movement-based problem by changing the biochemistry of the body. It doesn't work. There is no magical pill to make back pain go away, and there never will be. So you're better off avoiding surgery, according to this researcher. In 2010, they reviewed over 1,400 patients in Ohio, and they had a diagnosis of disc degeneration, a disc herniation, sciatica, again, back pain. Half the patients had surgery to fuse two or more of their vertebrae. The other half had no surgery, even though they had comparable diagnoses. After 2 years, only 26% of those who had surgery had returned to work. Again, these were workmen's compensation database claims, compared to 67% of the patients who did not have surgery. Of the lumbar fusion patients, 36% had complications, meaning something went wrong, and 27% required another operation. Permanent disability rates were 11% for patients who underwent surgery and only 2% who didn't have surgery. So, and what might be the most troubling finding is research determined that there was a 41% increase in the use of painkillers with a 70% risk of surgery, patients continuing opioid use after surgery. So 11%, there's a 41% increase that they were going to take pain meds in the first place if they had surgery, and then a 77% risk that surgical patients continued pain medication use after surgery. Not good. And 17 surgical patients died by the end of the study. So 17 of the 1,400 had died. You're better off not having surgery. That's what this study indicates. So what about injections? Again, we talked about the three most common treatments: medications, injections, and surgery for back pain. Not effective, short-term, if anything, results. Expensive, and they all have side effects. What about injections? So studies indicate that there are improvements in patients short-term that have sciatica or pain traveling down their leg, but it's short-term. There was little evidence to support long-term improvements and little to no evidence to support relief with back pain if somebody who had no leg symptoms, so just back pain by itself. And of course, there's risks, always risks. There's risk of infection. There was a local case back in 2012 here where there was tainted steroid injections with meningitis, so people were injected with basically a disease. They got sick. Some people died. Always risks. 2018, the American Medical Association came out with new physician guidelines for back pain. Here you go. Number one, do not routinely obtain imaging. So don't get an x-ray or an MRI only when severe red flags, which is motor weakness, bowel and bladder function changes, and signs of infection or fracture. Number two, advise to remain active. Don't rest. Number three, provide information about effective care. Number four, provide referrals to non-pharmacological therapy, aka physical therapy, which is what we're going to get into, and then MRIs only when surgery is required. So again, this paints a picture that science is really strongly indicating that non-pharmaceuticals, movement-based therapy is the answer to back pain, not surgery, not medications, not injections. So hopefully, so far, you're motivated for what I'm going to tell you is true. Science proves it. Let's move on.